Sugar is one of the most important things you keep in your kitchen, not just because it makes everything taste much better, but also because it's an essential ingredient in almost everything we eat. It's so important that the average person consumes about 77.1 pounds of sugar per year, which is equivalent to 16 teaspoons of sugar daily. But how is sugar made? Where does it come from? Today we're going to learn all about the making of sugar. So, sit tight while we walk through the steps of producing sugar from the farm to the table. Friendly warning, this video might give you a sweet tooth. Sugar was first produced for commercial use around 8000 BC by the indigenous people of New Guinea. Seeing how vital sugar is today makes one wonder how people in other parts of the world and outside New Guinea sweeten their foods. Sugar quickly became so valuable that it was often kept locked and hidden to avoid people fighting duels over who got the most sugar. Thankfully, sugar is produced in over 120 countries today, with Brazil being the highest sugar producer worldwide at 39.5 million tons yearly. This is followed closely by India, which produces 33.7 million tons of sugar per year. The United States produces nearly 10 million tons of sugar yearly, and the sugar production industry provides about 150,000 jobs. Did you know that about 80% of sugar comes from sugarcane, while the remaining 20% comes from sugar beets? That's right, not all sugar comes from the same plant, but after it's been processed and packaged, it's practically impossible to tell the difference between sugar made from sugarcane and sugar beets. So, let us now get into the step-by-step process of making sugar. Sugarcane is grown in warm and tropical regions such as Brazil, India, China, South Africa, and so on. By contrast, sugar beets thrive in temperate, colder regions like Russia, Germany, and some parts of South America. Once the sugarcane or sugar beets are ripe, they're harvested by the farmer using specialized machinery. Once the plants have been harvested, they're put through a sieve to remove dirt and rocks before being loaded onto trucks and transported to the factory. The sugarcane must be transported quickly and efficiently to avoid spoilage, because sugarcane gets spoiled easily. Once the sugarcane arrives at the factory, it's ready for the cleaning stage. As you'll see, cleaning and purity is an essential part of the sugar production process. Washing of the sugarcane is done by placing them on belts and spraying them with strong jets of water. This process removes most trash, rocks, leaves, and other unwanted things from the sugarcane. Washing can also be done in rotating drums, which water is sprayed into as the sugarcane rubs against itself to remove dirt. With the washing complete, the sugarcane is crushed using swing hammer shredders or heavily grooved crusher rollers. The crushed sugarcane is sprayed with hot water. For sugar beets, the next step is for the beets to be cut into smaller stripes using slicing machines. These stripes, called cossets, are usually smaller than French fries. The cossets are then soaked in hot water tanks. Using hot water on the sugar cane or sugar beets helps the plant cells swell, which is vital for the next step, which is to extract the juice. Juice extraction is done by feeding the crushed sugar cane into a milling tandem, which is made up of 5 mills that compress the sugar cane fiber and extract the sweet juice. After squeezing every bit of juice from the fiber, the juice is collected into large vats. What is left is the pulp, also known as bagasse. The bagasse has no further use for sugar making, but it can be stored and used later for fuel. The sugar cossets, on the other hand, are pumped into the base of tanks standing 10 to 20 meters tall. At the center of the tanks is a rotating shaft that draws the cossets upwards against the downward flow of water as the sugar is extracted. With the juice properly extracted, we can now process it. Although the sugar you get at the end of the day is usually white, the juice at this point is greenish or brownish and not quite sweet, so the juice has to be purified. But before that, the juice is sent to a lab where it goes through a series of quality assurance tests. After the juice passes all the tests, it's poured into 10 to 20 foot tall towers. At the same time, sulfur dioxide vapor is introduced to the tower from the bottom, and it rises to meet the juice at the top through a process called sulfitation. The next step is carbonation. The juice is heated to denature the protein content, then mixed with milk of lime, a slurry of calcium hydroxide. The whole point of carbonation is to further separate the soluble non-sugar materials for the sugar juice. Carbon dioxide gas bubbles can be introduced at this point to lower the juice's alkalinity and precipitate the carbonation sludge, which is then filtered to purify the juice. After carbonation, the cane juice is lighter in color and ready for the next step, clarification. Clarification is used to filter the juice, and it usually takes several hours. When it's done, the sludge must have settled to the bottom of the tank while the juice stays on top. After removing the juice, a secondary filtration removes any leftover sugar from the sludge. This produces a material called mud that can later be used as fertilizer for the sugarcane fields. So, you see, every part of the sugarcane has its function, even if it doesn't make it to the final sugar product. The now clarified juice can now be boiled in a series of vacuum evaporators until it reaches a concentration of 50 to 65% sugar. Each evaporator in this process has a higher vacuum pressure than the previous one, reducing the boiling temperature of the sugar syrup as it passes through evaporators. This process produces sediment on top of the sugar syrup, which is skimmed off using paddle skimmers. Eventually, we are left with a thick, almost colorless syrup. The next step in the sugar manufacturing process is called crystallization. During crystallization, a single-stage vacuum pan is used to evaporate the syrup until all that's left are sugar crystals, which are formed through a process called seeding. This involves adding a milky solution of pure sucrose suspended in alcohol and glycerin to the syrup to act as a seed. The solution contains small grains of sugar that serve as nuclei to draw out the sugar in the solution and convert it to crystals. While the mixture continues boiling in the vacuum pan, water evaporates from it, and sugar crystals keep growing. The result is a paste called massaquite, a dense mixture of syrup and sugar crystals. The massaquite is transferred into a larger container called the crystallizer, where it's slowly stirred as it cools down. Now we have to separate the massaquite into sugar crystals and molasses. This is done by adding the massaquite to a high-speed centrifuge, which rotates at about 1,000 to 2,800 revolutions per minute. The centrifuge's main feature is the perforated metal cylindrical basket that the molasses passes through during centrifugation. The molasses is drawn outside the centrifuge and then sent to storage tanks. The sugar crystals remain in the lined centrifuge basket, and spring water is used to wash the crystals as they're centrifuged. Our sugar is almost ready by now, but it still has a significant moisture content that might prevent it from having a long shelf life. So, the damp sugar crystals are placed in huge dryers that blast hot air at the sugar. This reduces the moisture content to as low as 0.02%. After that, the sugar is transferred to a granulator to dry it further. The granulator gently tumbles the sugar through heated air to form dried crystals separated by size through vibrating screens. They're then packed into storage bins, and subsequently, they'll be packed by a packaging machine. Finally, the sugar manufacturer sends the packaged sugar to distributors, who then send them to the different stores where you can pick them up. And that's how sugar is made, from the sugar cane getting harvested and then processed into packaged sugar. What other products would you like to learn about in terms of how they're made? Let us know in the comments. And don't forget to like, subscribe, and share for more content like this.